feisty, fearless, and fair. She's an Emmy-winning journalist from the White House to war zones, telling all sides of the story. This is The Rita Cosby Show.
Well, President Trump is going back to Butler, Pennsylvania. Christopher Wray is fessing up that, yeah, President Trump was shot by a bullet, and that's what injured him in his ear. And finally, it's nice to see a commander-in-chief talking tough about these pro-Hamas protesters that are going on all over the place. And I was really happy to see President Trump meeting also with Benjamin Netanyahu. They just wrapped up their meeting a little bit ago. Of course, the prime minister of Israel. And Israel is under attack from every different direction. And in fact, Prime Minister Netanyahu, when he did his speech, talked about how they are under siege in seven different directions, like seven different enemies, all most of them under the umbrella of Iran, of course. But he talked about, okay, you got Iran, you got the Hezbollah, you've got the Houthis, you've got Hamas, again, all under the umbrella of Iran. That looks like it is closer and closer to getting a nuclear weapon. And in the middle of all this, President Trump took note tonight about the contrast in the way that Israel has been supported under Kamala Harris versus when he was president. And he said Kamala Harris, who is vice president running right now, the presumptive nominee to run on the Democratic side for president, the fact that she gave Netanyahu basically the finger and said, I'm not showing up when he speaks on Capitol Hill, because she didn't want to sit behind him and clap because she knew that that would be used against her to her pro-Hamas voters in Michigan and elsewhere. I mean, give me a break. She is so playing politics, and this speaks volumes of her character. And then she meets with Netanyahu privately and comes out and has a statement that's sort of like blaming both sides, if you will, and blaming Israel for what's going on in Gaza, not mentioning that it's Hamas's fault. And also, I was astounded. She also did not say that her goal is to eradicate Hamas. She never brought up the eradication of Hamas. You have got to be kidding me that you have a meeting with Netanyahu who's describing barbarism versus civilization, that this is like the most pivotal, critical moment of their existence, essentially. You look back as to what happened to them since their state was formed and now what they're going through now. And she comes out and essentially blames Israel? Well, Netanyahu came out and apparently was furious, as were many others in Israeli leadership, and were stunned because they felt she was saying a very different thing privately than she's saying publicly. And again, that speaks volumes of somebody who plans and wants to be our next commander-in-chief. If she can get through this nomination process without her getting tossed out and replaced like what happened to Biden. I mean, this is insane. Here is President Trump just a little bit ago, and this is what he had to say about Kamala Harris and Israel and his views.
By contrast, Kamala Harris stabbed Israel in the back in its great hour of need. 2 days ago, she refused to attend the speech in Congress of the Prime Minister of Israel. She said, oh, I can't make it. There was just a small group of people, but they couldn't make it because that's her original thought. That's where she comes from. She doesn't like Jewish people. She doesn't like Israel. That's the way it is, and that's the way it's always going to be. She's not going to change. Together with Joe Biden, she gave billions and billions of dollars to Iran and Hamas to fund their campaigns of terror. She gave them billions of dollars. They were broke. Remember when I left, they were broke. There were stories that Hamas is out of business, Hezbollah is out of business. They were broke. October 7th would have never happened if I were president.
And you know what? I believe them in many ways because Iran was broke and now they are flush with cash. And I don't see Kamala Harris doing anything different than the Biden regime. Actually, I do. I think she will be worse for Israel and worse for America. That is very, very scary. Here is President Trump also talking about the war against ISIS.
The attack on Ukraine by Russia would have never happened. I spoke to President Putin often about it. It was the apple of his eye. He would have never done it. Wouldn't have done it. I said, you'll never do it. He would have never done it. It was only after I left that armies started aligning the border with Ukraine, armies. And I said, oh, he's just negotiating. He'll never do it. But he did it. He did it because we had a weak president. He did it also because our move out of Afghanistan was so incompetently done. And I think when he saw the way we did that, he said, wow, this is a paper tiger that we're dealing with. But they weren't a paper tiger with me. We defeated ISIS in 4 weeks instead of 5 years. It was supposed to take 5 years, 4 weeks.
What a contrast. From now, we have the president of the United States who's been all over the place. We have Kamala Harris who's been all over the place. And you have the Middle East on fire. And of course, what's going on with Russia, Ukraine. You've got China and Russia doing team warplane exercises off the coast of Alaska. This is a perilous time. 1-800-848-9222. President Trump going back to PA. And boy, what a message of clarity, peace through strength. It's refreshing because we haven't heard it for the last 3.5 years. Mike in South Carolina, your thoughts.
How you doing, Rita? Well, a lot has gone on this week, like you said. I mean, it's a potpourri of everything, you know.
Yeah, it sure is. It's been insane. It's been such a trying time for the world. What do you make of the fact that President Trump has said, I'm going to wait till we know who the actual nominee is before I agree to a debate, because it wouldn't be right to accept Kamala. She might not be there in 2 weeks, essentially, or 3 weeks.
Yes. It's like, you know, the way he put it, Donald Trump. And, well, I'll debate someone as long as I know who the nominee is.
It's a great point. It's a great point.
Yeah. And, you know, I've never seen somebody, you know, she plays the race cards, talks with her fingers and her hands, always laughing and smiling. Curtis calls it giggles. Oh, the border's fine. She's the czar of the border. And she gives a look like she's oblivious. What? I mean, same look that Biden gave, oblivious. And you know what? I'm glad Donald Trump is going back to Butler to finish the rally. And nobody speaks about it. And Donald Trump on his tape, you know, and you've mentioned it many times, nobody talks about October 7th. Always January 6th. Always the bombardment against, you know, the Republicans. Oh, Donald Trump. They never talk about October 7th when it really happened, when the you-know-what hit the fan. It's a sign of weakness, like you said, Rita, with Biden. And now here she is, talking with her fingers and her hands, Kamala Harris. Hey, Kamala, your husband seems like a nice Caucasian. He's Jewish. And that's the stance you take on Israel?
By the way, stepdaughter has also, I think, been out there protesting with some of these pro-Hamas protesters. Even though he's Jewish, his daughter is out there. And look, there are people in Israel you sometimes see, these left-wing protesters out there, who, despite everything that happened, are not for, you know, Israel going into Gaza. You know, they're not in for Israel necessarily eradicating Hamas. I don't know what the daughter's positions are, but the fact she's been out protesting speaks volumes. So, boy, I'm glad you brought that up, Mike. Thank you very, very much. Let's go to Sandra in New Jersey. Sandra.
Good evening, Rita. Rita, I was just thinking about Donald Trump returning to Butler. Well, first of all, you have to face your fear if he has any. you have to get back on the horse when you fall off. So it's good that he's going back.
By the way, I bet you he's got some fear, Sandra. I mean, you know, he's a pretty fearless guy, but I don't know how anybody would not be changed or affected by somebody, coming so close to an assassination attempt. To me, it's just such a powerful, heartbreaking moment that there's no way, I think, that they could not be affected.
I agree with that. So I think, you know, that's number one. And when you fall off a horse, if you get right back on, you're going to continue riding in your life. Now, they did advise him, I believe his team said no more outdoor rallies. And I thought I heard him say he's going to go along with that. But we don't know.
Well, they might pick a place like maybe not at that exact site. Maybe they're going to go, you know, in Butler to an arena or something nearby, or, you know, maybe there's something else. I'm trying to remember if I've been to Butler. I've been to Pennsylvania a lot. I've got to remember if I've been to Butler. I know I've been in that area. And the question is, is there some sort of auditorium or something? Maybe there's some compromise, and you could bet security is going to be tight as a drum. Right, Sandra?
Oh, no question about it. But going back to Donald Trump, you have to trace it, what happened. You have to face it, what happened, and then you erase it. So he has to do this because he's the type of person, this was incomplete, this is not how he planned it to go, so he wants to do it right, and he wants to honor that man, that fireman, Corey. That's also so important in his heart and his soul and for the people. So, and you know, I just want to say one thing. Donald Trump is a man of action. He is not words. He's action. He always takes action with everything that happens. And that's like amazing. Don't you think, Rita?
Yeah, it is. And even the way he's handled this, I mean, I've known Donald Trump for many years, and he's always a very resilient, tough guy who, you know, when he believes in something, he fights for it. He obviously believes in America and believes in what we stand for as a country, and sees the country in many ways, you know, falling apart, and is really frustrated by it, and wants to, quote, make America great again. And I can see him, you know, I can see why he'd want to go back. But I also think that this has been extraordinary. The way he's handled this whole thing, from getting up right away and fight, knowing that, you know, so many people in the crowd were worried if he was alive or dead, you know, and letting them and the world know he's alive and we're going to fight and the world's going to be, you know, the world and America are worth fighting for. And then going back and saying, I want to go back there. I want to go not only to show people for himself, but just as you said, to follow up. That shows a lot of strength and a lot of courage, and also a lot of understanding of what happened too. Just like you said, that he feels he has unfinished business, but he also wants the world to know that nothing will deter us. No matter what attack happens, no matter what, we will stand strong and we'll beat it. And so I think there's also a big metaphor for this moment too, in so many ways. Sandra, thank you very much. Let's go to Tony in Clifton. Tony, your thoughts. Tony, what do you think?
Rita, I'm delighted he's going to Butler. I think for someone who was in school during the Kennedy assassination, I think it's very important for the country to move forward and know that he's going to stay on track for America. And I think what I'm hearing this week is, first of all, he's telling Bibi Netanyahu to get this done. He is a man. He's almost like the man of Mar-a-Lago, La Mancha. You know, let's just do what we have to do.
As opposed to the man of La Mancha, the man of Mar-a-Lago.
Yes. And he knows that so much is at stake. Now, if you noticed, he's just beginning to talk about our Iranian connections inside the White House. We've talked about Robert Malley. We've had different people working inside our government, in the Defense Department, in the State Department. And our government is very compromised. And so for him to come up and speak to Prime Minister Netanyahu was just another reason why I love him. It's so important because we don't see this day to day, but if you put all the pieces together, our country is in grave danger. When you see everything that's happening, we think of Alaska and the, you know, China and all that's going on. And so at the end of the day, I really had sort of a wake-up moment today, Rita, when I thought of Kamala Harris. And I said, who is she? She's a woman who fell apart when Tulsi Gabbard asked her questions. She is going to crash and fall. I heard one of the sort of people who report on all this kind of stuff, I don't remember his name, Doug Schoen,
yep,
say that, you know, that President Obama wanted an open convention, and because Doug Schoen's Democrat, and he laid that out there. He said, but since it didn't go that way, he did it by phone call.
By the way, more than that, he was one of the last ones to endorse her. And there were reports, Tony, that he wanted to go a different direction because he did not think that she could beat President Trump. And that's their whole objective. That's why they pushed out Joe Biden. And reports are that Obama played a huge role in that. I mean, that was pretty public. And that he was upset that Biden kind of as payback quickly endorsed Kamala to kind of pay back Obama, if you will, because he was mad that Obama pushed him out and wasn't sure about Kamala. So it's an interesting sort of political game that's really going on. But the fact that Obama was one of the last people to endorse her clearly shows that she is not a shoo-in for the Democrats, and they know that. 1-800-848-9222. We'll continue your calls after the break.
You're listening to The Rita Cosby Show. This is The Rita Cosby Show.
Wait till you hear some of the things that Kamala Harris has said in her past about police officers, about illegal immigration, and a lot more. Buckle your seatbelts. We got a lot more ahead. Let's go to Dave in New Jersey real quick. Dave, your thoughts about President Trump.
Hello, Rita.
Hi there. Go ahead.
How are you? For a long time, a listener, a first time caller. I just have to ask you a couple of things, and then you'll tell me if you might agree with me. Remember the Representative Waters when she was in her, I believe, California, when she made a comment about, we must take Trump out tonight.
Yes,
and
yes.
Then Joe Biden with his bullseye. And then isn't it suspicious? Where was Hunter when this all happened? He wasn't around. He was always in the White House.
Yeah, although I hope you're not suggesting Hunter had anything to do with this. I don't know about that.
Cosby is on.
Well, many believe that if Kamala Harris gets elected, we will be at the point of no return. And if you look at her track record, boy, oh boy, the nonpartisan group GovTrack said she was the most liberal senator in 2019, even though they scrubbed it apparently from their site. But they did say it. And that means she was more liberal than Senator Bernie Sanders. I mean, you got to be left of the left of the left if that's the case. And I'm not surprised because a lot of the comments that she has made now in the past are coming back and people are seeing it left and right and saying, you know what? That's a little extreme. She's, of course, going to try to portray to the middle right now because she is not going to want people to think that she's extreme, that she's, oh, what do you mean? I would never say defund the police. I would never say these things. Well, guess what? You said it, and it's all on tape. Here's a little bit of what Kamala Harris said, first of all, about getting rid of police, that they really don't do that much, and adding police doesn't really help fight crime. Listen to what she said in the past about law enforcement.
Defund the police. The issue behind it is that we need to reimagine how we are creating safety. And when you have many cities that have one third of their entire city budget focused on policing, we know that is not the smart way and the best way or the right way to achieve safety. If for too long, the status quo thinking has been you get more safety by putting more cops on the street. Well, that's wrong. Because by the way, if you want to look at upper middle class suburban neighborhoods, they don't have that patrol car. They don't have those police walking those streets. But what they do have, they have well-funded schools. What they do have is home ownership, high home ownership rates. What they do have are thriving small businesses. What they do have is access to public health and mental health services. So this whole movement is about rightly saying, we need to take a look at these budgets and figure out whether it reflects the right priorities.
What a loony kazoony. This is coming at a time where if you see shoplifting is escalating, they just put metal detectors, gun detecting technology at the Fulton Street subway in New York City because people are so scared to get on the subway at this major mass transit. And they set up this technology going through the bags and other things, lots of law enforcement. But they just set it up a couple hours ago at the Fulton Street station, which is a big station in New York City. About 4 p.m., it was ahead of the rush hour commute, and a sign of the times. And she's talking about praising getting rid of police. This is absolutely the wrong time to have somebody like that where the country is already in crisis. And then you're going to add somebody like this? And she's, of course, playing the politics game. Oh, no, we're just going to attack Trump. Her record is on display, and she's made a lot of statements that are going to come back to bite her. And I hope the average person listening goes, you know what? Maybe we need a lot more police. Maybe they're incredible, honorable people, which they are, which is why we salute them every night and are back the blue every night here on the Rita Cosby Show. And it's not only her stance on police. Listen to what she said on undocumented immigrants. She said, you know what? None of these people who cross the border are criminals. They're not illegals. That's not nice to say. And they should get every perk in the book. Listen to what she said. Take a listen to that.
An undocumented immigrant is not a criminal, and we have to correct course in this conversation.
We have to correct course. And then we just pulled this little doozy up tonight. Here she is in 2016. Not only is she playing word salad about undocumented immigrants, illegal aliens, illegal immigrants, she's playing word salad with radical Islam, radical Islamic terrorists. Remember, 2016, we're all worried about it, but she says that's not nice to call the terrorists that.
You must have the courage to object when they use that term. Radical Islamic terrorism, which ignores how Muslims have overwhelmingly been the greatest victims of terror. And we must also have the courage to reject that term, illegal alien. I have seen some of the worst of criminal behavior. I have seen the worst of crime. An undocumented immigrant is not a criminal.
An undocumented immigrant is not a criminal. They're allowed to come into this country unvetted, come in illegally, but don't call them a criminal. And let's remember, look what's been happening to so many of our great cities across the country. Our budgets are skyrocketing, are busting through the seams. Think about how many different American veterans and other people could really benefit from being able to have the resources that are going to illegal aliens and illegal undocumented immigrants. And this is what Larry Kudlow, the great economist, of course, on Fox Business. He also hosts Larry Kudlow on WABC on Saturday mornings. And Larry said, if Kamala Harris were to step into the Oval Office, this country will change forever and it will go broke.
Because of the open border that she supported, she and Joe Biden. So the numbers are hard to come by with precision. Right. She got about 7.5 million illegals, probably another 2 million so-called gotaways. So call it 9.5 million, more or less. The estimates from the Congressional Budget Office, it's already cost us $150 billion. Okay, $150 billion. And you know, in New York City, Eric Adams has, I don't know, he estimated $12 billion. But that was a while ago. The cost is probably higher. So she wants all these entitlements to take care of the illegals, education, health care, food, and so forth. And that will bankrupt. I mean, as though we're not bankrupt already. But once those things ever went into place, you know, entitlements never die. I mean, you'll be running into trillions of dollars because of an open border policy that, if she were elected president, she will continue the open border policy. At least there's no question in my mind. So the financial part of this story, the economic part of the story, is terrible.
A frightening thought. Unless you want to have millions upon millions, and some people estimate at the end of a potential Kamala Harris presidency, we could see another 30 to 40 million illegal aliens in this country. That is really a frightening premise, guys. 1-800-848-9222. I am all for legal immigration, but they need to be vetted. They need to be checked. Let's go to Frank in Staten Island. Frank, your thoughts.
Oh, hi. Oh, good. I just got on. Yeah. This is like terrible with Kamala Harris. The first time I heard of her was during the hearings with Brett Kavanaugh. And those hearings went from a man trying to get on the Supreme Court to a man trying to fight for his life because now he was accused of attempted rape. She totally believed this Christine Blasey fraud, that he had done attempted rape on this girl when he was 15 years old. Crazy nonsense. Just there's no evidence for this. But Kamala Harris wanted to put him in jail or wanted to ruin his reputation. A married man with two daughters. Amazing. What Kamala Harris believed this fraud. And that's when I couldn't stand her. And I'll never want her for president.
And I will say, Frank, you know, I remember those hearings, just like you're saying. And you know what is interesting? She's saying that that's essentially what she's going to probably try to do to President Trump. She's going to say, oh, he's a threat to democracy. I'm a prosecutor and I'm going to prosecute what she calls the persecutor. So it's going to be, I think you're actually, your analogy, sadly, of what happened, you know, with, you know, Blasey Ford, and also more importantly, what happened with Brett Kavanaugh, the way she handled Brett Kavanaugh. I think that's exactly what we're going to see her try to do with Trump. How do you suggest President Trump respond? Should it get to a debate with the two of them?
Yeah, he has to mention like some things that she did. He has to fight back. They have to do some research on her, and he has to really get some really good comebacks on her background and stuff. She's no angel in any of this. Wait, what she did in California?
Yeah, well, look, and we just played some really, really stunning stuff that just came out just now that is really shocking to its core when you see what she said and how extreme she is. I mean, she's making Joe Biden look moderate. Frank, thank you so much. Let's go to Stan in Forest Hill. Stan, your thoughts.
I agree that people have to stand in line and to get into this country. Absolutely. It's been too much. Absolutely, you're right.
Great.
But not everybody is a criminal. She's right.
By the way, I agree, but she
is right.
But she's
not,
saying,
wait a minute, not
Stan,
everybody
she's
coming
saying
in here.
Everybody
are
who
that's
comes
the way it's supposed
in,
to look in the Republican
she's
Party.
She's saying everybody who comes in deserves free education, free health care, free housing, and to heck with, you know, you American citizens, essentially. She and have you seen them do a really good job of vetting? Because I haven't. And she's the border czar. If they try to erase it or not, that's the reality. You think she's done a good job with the border for the last 3.5 years? I don't think so,
Stan. I didn't see her do much on the border, to be honest.
I agree. I agree. That's the whole point.
But as many millions have come in, and again, they should go out, stand in line, and wait.
Yeah, vet them. I agree.
Wait, well, but,
Stan, vet them.
Wait a minute. But not all of them are made out as like Trump. Everybody, he called them criminals. This, that.
He did not.
The most racist
Stan,
statements Stan, I've ever heard.
He
He's
did not.
The worst.
You know what he said? He said that Venezuela is sending their criminals to the United States.
I agree.
Okay.
Not the whole country.
He didn't
but
say.
But he makes it out as if the
That's
worst That's
how
of the worst
you interpret it,
in.
Stan. That's not what he's saying. He's saying that there
he
are
said
bad
exactly
people.
That.
Stan, let
so
me
you
ask you.
To
Stan,
what he says?
Stan, I actually do, and maybe
so
you
do
need
I.
to.
He
Stan,
means exactly
let
what
me
he
ask
says.
You, Stan. How many people committed 9/11? How many hijackers committed 9/11?
Hijackers? What are you talking
I'm
about?
I'm talking about 19 people who overstayed their visa.
Yeah, I mean, on the plane, right?
Yeah,
on the plane.
Yeah. Remember?
What about
yeah.
it?
What
about what
I'm
it?
Saying is that it only took 19 people to cause death and destruction on America.
I'm not arguing
and
that.
And that's what
correct.
It does. And what
and
my
maybe,
point is, you got to vet them.
The
I agree with you, but
ran
vet them.
The country, like George Bush and the rest of them were on the job, it might not have happened. So maybe he should have been impeached and thrown the hell out. Go ahead.
Stan, that's an interesting point. Thank you. I'm glad I can speak on my own show. First off, in terms of George W. Bush, obviously they missed the intel. There are a lot of people that missed the intel. They knew that there was something in the works, but they missed the intel. That's clear. But I didn't see him saying, hey, let's leave our allies high and dry like Biden did in Afghanistan. Let's pull out all the U.S. troops, even though his military told them to stay there. Let's abandon Bagram and let's have the prisoners roam wild, which is what exactly happened with his withdrawal. And guess what? This president has made no efforts. They have now anywhere from 10 to 15 million illegals under this president. It is the biggest amount historically. They have over 200 people on the terror watch list. A lot of those guys who flew the planes into the United States and into those, you know, our Twin Towers and also, of course, the Pentagon and the other plane that went down in Shanksville, Pennsylvania, some of them were not on the terrorist watch list. So you got to really worry about the 200 that are. You know how many, Stan, let me just ask you a question. Do you know how many on the terrorist watch list came through under President Trump? Do you know how many entered under his 4 years?
I don't think he knows.
Actually, we do know. And let
that's what your numbers show.
Let me straighten you out.
You having kids
let me
out,
straighten
Rita.
You out. It's 11 of them total. And under Biden, it's been over 250. That's the known ones. You can imagine how many unknown are in this country thanks to an unvetted, wide-open border. And that's why you can't have it. And you shouldn't have a future president who wants even more of that. That is the definition of insanity at a time like this where we're so worried about our security. And I would hope, I'm glad you realize that people need to be vetted because that's what this is all about. I'm all for legal immigration. I think immigrants have added so much value to this country, but they need to be checked. They need to be vetted. I'm a first generation American, Stan. Both of my parents came. They studied, they learned the language, they came over, and they kissed the ground in America every day they were alive. They appreciated this country so much, and they love this country. But they were vetted. It took them years to become a citizen. It took that they had to have a sponsor. There were all these things. They talked about how difficult it was, but they cried when they became American citizens. And there are so many great American citizens now today that felt the same way as my parents do. But guess what? That's what you need. You want people. You don't want people who have criminal records coming across the border. And I don't think any country or any leader should want that. And sadly, we have somebody who looks like is going to be the next presumptive, right now the presumptive, maybe it looks like, likely, the nominee on the Democratic side who said, come one, come all. We won't worry about it, and we'll also take care of you. That's a double whammy, Stan, and you got to admit that. We'll continue your calls after the break. 1-800-848-9222. 9222. And now to our Support Our Heroes.
The Rita Cosby Show presents Support Our Heroes.
And this is the Tunnel to Towers Foundation Support Our Heroes segment with a powerful story coming from Sydney, Ohio. The Shelby County Fair in Sydney, Ohio, recently honored veterans, where veteran James Moorman was declared Veteran of the Year. There was also a guest speaker there, Jerry Mullenkamp. He's an Army veteran. Both he and his son served in the White House Communication Agency. He made a major point to everybody at the gathering that the number one underrated person in the United States is the volunteer. How beautiful is that? Appreciating the service and sacrifice of volunteer. I mentioned that the person of honor who got the Veteran of the Year award was a veteran named James Moorman. He served in the military. He was in the U.S. Air Force from 72 to 1974. Then he joined the Air National Guard, where he then served with the Office of Special Investigation for a total of 10 years military service. Also, by the way, that wasn't enough service for him. He devoted his career after that as a Shelby County, Ohio Sheriff's Deputy for 28 years. And of course, we always love honoring our men and women in the military. And everybody, be sure to help America to never, ever forget. Just donate $11 a month to the Great Tunnel to Towers Foundation. Check them out at t2t.org, the Great Tunnel to Towers Foundation. They're the best. They do so much to help America's military and first responder heroes. T2T.org.
You're listening to The Rita Cosby Show. It's the Rita Cosby Show.
It was a beautiful day. Sun beat down. I heard the radio on. I was driving.
And we are continuing with your calls, everybody. President Trump doing another rally or so this weekend. And again, the big news is that he will go to Butler, Pennsylvania. Now that the FBI director has also conceded that, yeah, it was a bullet that shot him. By the way, the New York Times is pushing to try to get the health records of President Trump from the shooting, saying, oh, we need to see it. It's like, wait a minute. They didn't ask for the health records of Joe Biden all this time. They've essentially covered up, if you will, for Joe Biden. A lot of the reporters saying how spry he was for years upon years until that debate. But, oh, boy, they got to get the records of President Trump. Real quick, let's go to Jacqueline real quick. Line three. Jacqueline, your thoughts real quick.
But since Emperor Obama and his wife have anointed Kamala Harris their candidate, this country is going down the tubes. Partly thanks to callers like your last one and those that feel the way he does.
Well, the bottom line is, everybody, get out and vote in November. There's a couple months till Election Day. Get out. Voting makes a difference.